Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Oh man, I thought we could do it the first time. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I blame the food truck, the food, right? Did everybody get something to eat?
Yes.
Awesome. Hope it was delicious.
Thank you.
Welcome to our 2023 Female Artists Initiative Showcase Recital. You know, it's been 3 years since we've done this in person, so I'm so grateful that we could do that this year. Before we present the performers, I just want to say a few words, quick words. For those who don't know me, my name is Najib Wong. I'm the program director. And you're here today to celebrate all our female artists, not just the ones who are performing today, but all of them, all 50 of them. There's so many achievements, but there are some of the few that I'd like to highlight. One, female artists are diversifying the top youth ensembles in Philadelphia. So representation has risen 6 times since the program started. That's amazing. Two, colleges know that our female artists are graduates. They're well prepared, so they're actively recruiting our students. That means they're accepted into top programs with a lot of scholarship money, over $1 million of scholarships awarded. Our alumni are, you know, they're past the college point now, first year, 6 years now, and they're getting jobs, and they're jobs in nonprofits. They're starting their own nonprofits, and of course, you know, our first year alumni, Nazir McFadden, is the assistant conductor of the Detroit Symphony, so that's exciting. But perhaps what you may not realize is that all of you are part in making this possible. Right, because you're part of this community that never existed before, and one that validates the value of high quality music education, and most importantly, believe that our students can achieve through dedication, discipline, and perseverance. So I want to thank all our students for working really hard, our parents for providing crucial support, especially emotionally, our teachers, pianists, staff, student advocates who work with our families, our partner organizations, allies, volunteers that provide numerous opportunities such as concerts, masterclasses, workshops, summer programs, our individual donors, and our main sponsor, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, for funding our program. Last but not least, I want to say a special thank you to our manager, Annie Gibler. I think she's over there. Just been with us for over a year, but she's done amazing work, and I probably drive her crazy on a daily basis. It's true. Can we give ourselves all a big round of applause? So before we get to the performance, and it's going to be a fantastic one, just so much diversity on stage as well as in the repertoire that they've chosen. I'd like to invite someone else to say a few words. It has been a real pleasure to see her, to experience her music making and see her grow. So please give a warm welcome to second prize winner of the Sphinx Competition Junior Division, Gabriela Salvador Riera.
Thank you so much for the introduction. So I think last time I was in an in-person showcase was back in 2019, before I was even a PMA artist, and I was here like marveling at all the performers. So this is pretty crazy standing up here in front of you all. Honestly, when Dr. Wong asked me to do the speech, I was like, who am I to stand up here in front of my own peers, you know, my equals, as if I'm any more qualified to do this. But I did realize that over the past couple months, I have learned a lot that I think is of value to share. So as Dr. Wong mentioned, some of you may know that a couple of weeks ago, I made it to the finals of the Sphinx competition in Detroit, the junior division, and I received second place. And that week was one of the most transformative times in my life. I felt the freest on stage that I have ever felt. And the emotion that I radiated during that performance earned me some of the most fruitful conversations with people I now consider dear friends, peers, and mentors. And so the period that comes after a great milestone like this, the period of reflection, I've come to realize can bring a whole lot of perspective and maturity to a person. I've learned a lot about what it's like to be flexible, confident, humble, consistent, patient, tough, and kind to myself. Basically, playing music at the level that we're at with the passion and the commitment that we have is both the greatest gift and the greatest challenge. So as I thought about what I wanted my message to be today, I wanted to share some of the challenges I've been tackling and lessons I've been learning lately as a girl blooming from a student to a well-rounded artist, as Dr. Wong would say. So I have three basic points I want to talk about today. One is recognizing and appreciating growth. Two is navigating, aiming at a moving target. And three is prioritizing your musical voice. So one, recognizing and appreciating growth. So there's this dynamic perspective that I have yet to find with my growth on my instrument. One aspect is a straight sort of outsider indifferent view on progress within a practice session. So it means not leaning on the side of I'm not getting enough done with this within this amount of time, because then I guarantee that we will fall into frustrated repetitions that whirlpool us into a worse mental and physical state. And that includes being less focused, less excited, less nurturing, and reinforcing bad habits, frankly. But on the other side of the coin, there's making sure you're getting to enough within a practice session, right? So knowing when it's time to move on. When you start feeling that you need a fresh view on the passage, for example, it means that you need to come back to it later. And then there's the aspect of setting healthy high standards. This goes into my second point a little bit, but part of this dynamic perspective on growth means setting high standards. Not in a way where you feel pressured to hit the standard, but in the way where you believe that you're truly good enough to reach this incredible milestone. Like, look at me go, I'm gonna kill this. A sort of a proving yourself wrong mindset. And then there's the aspect of being truly proud at your growth. Looking back on where you were at this point last year, for example, how secure you felt with your instrument, I guarantee you will have seen it come a long way. Even where you were at this point last month, for example, two weeks ago, you know, whatever it is, celebrate yourself, because you're doing one of the hardest things and one of the hardest mental challenges that there is out there, and that's making music. And then two is navigating, aiming at a moving target. So we as music students constantly reach goals, however small, and next thing you know, there's a new goal staring at you in the face before you've even had time to celebrate what you just did. So how do we tackle these constantly moving targets and remember that, here comes the cliche, it's the journey, not the destination that matters. So it's remembering the why, which I think I heard from Ray Chen at some point, he's wise. The first and most essential part to keeping up with constant increasing goals is to stay in touch with our musical why, remembering why we love to play, facing our whys every day, tuning into the joy that it brings us, reminding ourselves of not the burden and the pressure that comes with being a musician with eyes on you, you know, in all directions, but of the reason you continue every day. That can be achieved by just picking up your instrument, playing whatever you feel, improvising, or playing your favorite piece or song without worrying about analyzing your own playing at that moment. And then the second aspect to being able to aim at higher and higher targets is sticking to your values, not your goals. If you latch all of your musical abilities worth on how well you achieve a certain goal, an audition, competition, performance, etc., then we're never gonna be truly fulfilled. If we do it well, then we'll find ourselves empty-handed thinking, what's next? And if we don't reach the milestone we were expecting to, then we'll tie that to our own personal worth, and then that can be very detrimental. So it's not working towards your goal, working primarily towards your artistic values. Goals would be the stepping stones along the way. And then there's prioritizing your musical voice. So there are many ways that this can look. I would often find myself sitting in class thinking this would be the perfect time to practice. I feel so focused right now and I'm wasting it on math class. Now that's a personal example, but it often looks like simply not feeling the right amount of energy at that point in the day, and you really don't feel like practicing. Unfortunately, sometimes though, you're gonna have to practice at the time which isn't your prime. But this only builds up your strength and it's worth it. It's like, you know, you're an Olympic athlete, as Dr. Wong would say, once again. The more you step out of your comfort zone this way, the easier it'll become in the future. And the biggest hurdle is just getting started. It may take a while to get in the zone, but it will come if you allow it. Doing this is prioritizing your musical voice, however imperceptible. And then another way you can prioritize your musical voice over other outside factors is performing to share your arts and not to be judged upon it. Meaning, when going on stage, you're not only humbled and grateful to be there, but also we know deep down that we deserve to be there and we can't wait to share our gift with our audience. No matter how long it takes to truly believe it, which it's taken me years and I'm still working on it every single day, we have to keep reminding ourselves that the audience didn't come to look for flaws in our playing. They came to enjoy. So this positive energy that if you're able to radiate, people absolutely love it and they will point it out after a performance. And then the last aspect that I want to talk about for prioritizing your musical voice is treating practice as taking care of yourself and lifting yourself up. Our practice is exploring the boundaries of our instrument and our phrasing. So take those risks, play everything kind of weird. Our practice time is our chance to do that. This is the time for us. Our music making is not in the end for our teacher or for our orchestra director or for our chamber coach, although their approval and guidance is vital as well. It's there to serve your musical voice at the end of the day. All right, that's all I got for you. Thank you so much. I'm so excited to share the stage with and listen to all of you share your music today. But first, I'd like to thank the people that have helped me learn these valuable lessons. I could not be here without Dr. Wong and Ms. Gibler and every single thing PMA has done for me. It's been like an absolutely vital part of my journey here, especially in the past year. And I would like to thank my teacher, Ms. Beard, who, you know, since the beginning of the school year has absolutely transformed my confidence, and my mother, of course, for putting up with me all the time and everything she does. So thank you, everyone who's guided me and my entire support system, and you, my peers, for being part of one of the greatest communities. All right, now enough of me talking. Let's hear some music. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Foster for 2008 Mark.
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Miro Raj, and I will be playing the Vinyasa Scared to the Turn. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, at this time, we'd like to invite all performers and their family up on stage for some photo taking. Thank you very much. Have a good night.